Fragile X syndrome is caused by an unusual gene. This particular gene is on the X chromosome, and that means that girls have two copies of it and boys have a single copy. Everybody has this gene, and everybody has a typical repeating pattern of chemicals in the gene. But in people who've got the condition, that's disrupted and elongated, and it stops the gene working. If there's a change in that Fragile X gene in a boy, you can see the full effect of it. But in a girl, she will only use one copy of the gene in all of her cells and switch off the second copy. And that means that it can mask the effects to some extent. Because Fragile X syndrome is due to a change on the X chromosome, it can be inherited and run in the family. Women have two X chromosomes, and if they have a change in one copy of the Fragile X gene on one of those X chromosomes, they will have a 50-50 chance of passing that on to any child. But actually, the inheritance and genetics is quite complex, so everybody needs to seek out information about their own individual situation and genetics.
One should be considering Fragile X syndrome in any individual with unexplained intellectual disability, in particular, but not necessarily, in association with autistic-like features. It should be part of a routine assessment battery undertaken by a developmental paediatrician.
Fragile X syndrome is diagnosed when somebody has a clinical suspicion about it and arranges a test. The test that we do nowadays looks at the gene in a lot of detail and tells us how big that stretching of the gene is and whether there's the other chemical alteration that stops the gene working, which is methylation. So it's a blood test to look directly at the gene that we do.
On the 18th month, we had the diagnosis of Fragile X syndrome. We haven't heard anything about it before. We were like, fragile what? And then, you know, the geneticist explained to us.
We also need to test other people in a family who might be carriers or at risk of the condition, so that when someone's diagnosed, they usually come and see a genetic doctor or genetic counsellor and work out who in the family might need to be tested as well.
Blood was taken from all four of us. They said that they were going to check Susan and I being twins, but they felt sure that we couldn't be identical because I was supposedly not affected, whereas Susan is. But when the tests came back, they proved that we were identical. At the time, they didn't really understand why that could be, but now it's something to do with X inactivity in women, and I'm lucky.
Diagnosis is important for a number of reasons. Firstly, the individual and their family have a right to know why the person is experiencing these developmental and psychological challenges. And that goes a long way in relieving the sense of uncertainty and facilitating the grief reaction which happens for every individual and family following the release of a diagnosis.
When Ramaya was first diagnosed, it's like, okay, that's why it's that, given that sort of thing in it. That's why he's like
quite,
he is.
Because there's quite a lot of stuff going on with him.
Because at sometimes, I think, I don't know about you, but I think sometimes you think, oh gosh, you're doing something wrong as a parent. You know, what are we doing wrong as a parent? Or we put him in the wrong setting. It's all those kind of questions come up. But then it's like, oh no, it's none of those things. It's, you know, there is a reason.
For the girls, obviously, having that diagnosis, it's just really scary. And you wonder what their lives will be. And, you know, you obviously, at 4 years old and 18 months old, you scroll forward until they're 40 and you're no longer there, etc. And you worry and you panic and you just start thinking about how to put a structure in place for them.
With Jason and Gary, once we were told there was a medical reason for them being the way they were, that we didn't have to give excuses out. We didn't have to make excuses for Jason going like that.
Because I'm a geneticist, the thing that I think it helps with is particularly understanding who might be at risk in the family, who might be a carrier, and thinking about planning further children with that information to hand.
We have a lot of information that we can give on individual strengths and needs profiles, and that helps us to commence appropriate interventions as soon as possible to prevent later challenges. Last but certainly not least, it allows individuals in the family to relate to an appropriate support network and group, in this instance, the UK Fragile X Society.
Diagnosis made sense because he wasn't hitting his milestones. He was quite latent in developmentally. So it made sense. And also it brought tons of other questions, you know, how are we gonna do this? What's he gonna be like? What's the potential? You know, how can we help him? And, you know, all sorts of questions.
The diagnosis is one thing, but then what I kept hearing was all the negative side of stuff. Yeah. I wasn't hearing about anything that he could do.
Yeah.
And then, so for me, just seeing little bits of progress made me think, well, maybe we could do something to make him progress further than what they're telling him.
Yeah.
He actually started to progress socially first.
Yeah.
And that just kind of made me, and I guess you as well, think like, actually, he's already beaten targets that people have said. So that gave me hope about we were doing the right thing.
When you get that diagnosis, it does lift a big onus off you. It helps you understand it a lot more. And it makes you appreciate the kids. Because I'm going to fill up here. But it gives you that out. Like, whereas before you think, they're going to be. You know, like, you get over these kids now. If you were given a little bit of time and things like that, and see where they're coming from, you'd probably understand them a lot more.
There's a light at the end of the tunnel.